question. I'm kind of confused, I guess, on the arbitration part where you have a dispute with someone and you know, you have an arbitrator, which I guess you said you can pick. If I just had my first conflict, I don't know, I guess I just pick someone with a high reputation, I don't know. And then, I don't know, how does that play out? And then legally, how is it enforced?
So, like I say, there's no police or other like physical legal enforcement, but you have the multi-signature wallets, like I said before. So, before you even have a conflict, for every agreement, you will need to choose an arbitrator. So that is already secure that, like in the future, you will not be able to change, for example, depending on what kind of problem you had, or maybe you were corrupt or whatever, to change the arbitrator. Before you even set, before you even start doing anything, you choose the arbitrator. It should be someone that both parties agree upon, and that is, let's say, someone who is specialized in this kind of industry or the kind of contract that you're doing. And also, the funds, like I said before, they're locked in this multi-signature wallet. So the enforcement would basically be all about the money, like whether someone gets it or not. So there's a financial incentive to comply to this contract, else the arbitrator will be able to keep it locked.
And the arbitrator gets a fee? So.
Yes, the arbitrator is paid in PET tokens, so that's why it's also Pangea arbitration token. So arbitrators earn PET tokens, which they can exchange for money or for other tokens as they wish.
From resources, not from the parties.
This is what we offer, this is what we create, the Pangea arbitration token, and this is to incentivize this arbitration market. And for example, when people, like I said before, when people complete agreements and they earn PET tokens for their good reputation, they can also use this again to buy arbitration services again for another contract.
So what's to stop me from making just a ton of small, smart contracts and just boosting my reputation to the sky? I mean,
because they're
all treated equally, right? A marriage certificate is treated the same as me selling something to someone, anything. I mean, they're all equal, they all pay the same. So why not just spam it until I have, I don't know, am I understanding it right? I don't know, like, that's what I'm asking.
No, we have an anti-spam measure, which is that you have to pay whenever you set up a new contract or a new, when you make a new agreement, you also have a fee that you have to pay. So if you want to spam the network, you need to spend a lot of money, and this is like this incentive. And I didn't get the part about that all contracts are equal, or what do you mean, like for
things
equal?
You said you're rewarded a reputation point, right? Mm-hmm. So these reputation points are all equal thing, right? You do one contract, you get one reputation point. It's not simple. You don't get 10 if you do like something really good. You don't get, you know, 1 if you do something small. They're all the same. So if I wanted to get a high reputation, I would just do the smallest thing I could think of and just boost it up. Yeah, I got to pay a little bit of money. Okay, fair. But still, I'd pay the minimum I could and just boost the hell out of it. Mm-hmm. And then... God, everyone would love me. I'd have the highest reputation. I could do anything. I could get contracts with anyone. I mean, it would just. And
so,
I wouldn't say I deserve it at that point. Like, it's artificial.
I believe that it should not be equal. Like, I think we're also in the design stage of this right now, like how it should be distributed exactly. And I think the AI bot should have like some parameters to choose. Whether like specific work like deserves more or less, it's a good concern because you would just do like some minimum amount of work to get free PET tokens or to get to attack the system with this kind of civil attack to just get a higher reputation for actually not being very responsible because you just did something very easy. And also another concern is, of course, that you could have pseudonymous accounts Like you would probably also come up with this that you could just create fake accounts and then do like contracts with yourself. So yes, as of the moment you could do this, but it should be expensive because of setting up the agreements. So we would have to see like how the like benefits and cost balances between like earning free hat tokens for the reputation and the costs for creating new agreements. But I think we're also still just designing like the exact allocation of the reputation tokens.
I think he has a point that cost alone isn't enough. It's with just cost, you can't just pay for the reputation in some way.
But who would be like really interested in like paying a lot of money just to have a good reputation on the platform?
With a good reputation, you might be able to get contracts that pay more.
Yeah, it makes sense, but
that's what it's based on, right? This is all based on reputation. Mm-hmm. That's how you get favored by all other nations. That's what this is. So if you can boost that,
yeah,
however way possible, then
there are probably ways to look at like network activity to notice if a bunch of new accounts are boosting someone's reputation to count that less than if some other account with high reputation is doing a contract with them.
Yeah, maybe there should be some other limits. I'm not sure. Like maybe that when it's coming like from the same IP address, or when it's like, you know, like there should be some basic measures to avoid this kind of botnet.
I just had decent discussion on something like that on Steam at some point.
But yeah, certainly it's a good point. Like something we should work on.
What if my reputation is really bad for some reason? I don't know, some bad things, but I want to, you know, boost it.
The thing is, you have no negative reputation. You can only get like positive reputation tokens whenever you successfully complete something, but you can only have zero or something.
So it's not very beneficial to join like later, because there'll be a lot of people who joined before and will have a lot of reputation. My incentive to join decreases with time.
It depends. Maybe you're like in a very specific niche that just didn't exist before, or But yeah, it's a good point that the people who were there before can have a better reputation and they will get all the jobs. And yes, I know what you're talking about.
But you can issue a reputation token every year, for instance.
Mm. Also, one idea I had, I'm not sure we're implementing this, if we could have a decay mechanism that reputation can be burned over time.
Yeah.
So that you have to keep earning new reputation tokens and that the old ones are burned after a certain time period.
Mm-hmm.
Yes?
Because of big corruption in Slovakia and not working jurisdiction system. We are making exactly the same system like you, but maybe in some case we will not have enough judges in arbitrage. Like you can be, for example, it will be possible to some interoperability between your arbitrages and our agreement.
Yeah, that would totally make sense. We also interoperate with crowd jury. Which is a different way of solving conflicts. Like we have this market with like individual arbitrators, but you could also have a jury like that is coming from anywhere that like makes decisions together. And you can also probably integrate with us. I think it would make sense to like have a common market.
And are there any open APIs?
I think in general, like we do almost everything on GitHub, so I think it should be there. I have to check as well. Like I'm not 100% sure. I think some things should not be there because then, like probably all the work that it invested could be just easily copied, and that would also be a threat. But I think really the whole backend part is there on GitHub, but maybe the API, I'm not sure, that's like one very costly aspect that would be dangerous to just let everyone have access to it.
And why why do you avoid implementing the bad, eventually bad reputation? Because I'm thinking like that would be the only sort of equivalent to the punishment in our real world, and the only negative motivation for those who are thinking, considering not acting on the decision of the arbitrator, you know.
But wouldn't it also be just like the incentive that you get a zero reputation? I mean, that's.
So what? I mean, like, this is my thinking. You know, interesting.
But look, I mean, if you don't complete the contract, you will just not get the money, and then, like, what was the point?
I mean, what if you, like, trick people in a big way, and there's, like, no punishment?
You need to distinguish the scammers. Between somebody who actually didn't do anything.
Excuse me, I didn't
interact with society in any way, so I have zero reputation. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, there's somebody who's a scammer, and he also has zero reputation because it's a bad thing, so how to distinguish between these people?
Just feels super
awful.
But do the scamming and fulfill a few contracts, then you get a boosted reputation despite starting a bunch of contracts and fucking around with it.
I mean, yeah, like I said before, we need to like think about the incentives and about the costs and maybe there should be some way to back the scammers. I'm not sure. But it should be like secure that this is not that this cannot be abused, that you cannot blacklist someone who actually didn't do anything just because you said it. So like there we need to like if we implement something like this, there should be also some because we like have this also idea of innocent until proven guilty. So you should not be able to just ostracize or to blacklist someone just. Because you don't like him, or because you have like enough people who think, okay, like we don't like him, we don't want him to do anything on this platform. No, we want like to give everyone the equal opportunities as well to also do something, to create something.
But you have everyone's history with the contract, don't you?
Yeah, so you would see if the history he was already doing a lot of contracts where he gained zero reputation.
So you should be able to. Actually, the algorithm that you uncover those.
Yeah, you could probably also build some plugin or whatever, like something on top of it to track this history.
How is someone registered in Bitnation or in a nation? By some email, by some real physical nation ID, passport? How?
It will be all done in the Pangea app that we're launching now. So they will create a wallet where you will create a new public address, and I think this will be used. That's basically your membership will be this public address. So just from the start, you do not give away your physical identity, and just like in any other crypto or blockchain project, you use pseudonymous IDs like these public addresses. But of course, you can additionally.
Depending on the number of users you will have. So, I don't know, you will pick a nation and it will stop working because it's not good enough, better, so you will leave to another one. Do you take your reputation with you?
I think there's three different types of like reputation tokens. So that's like also something that you need to consider. So you have the proof of agreement, which is like that everyone individually earns, which is independent from nations. So this you can also earn this without being part of any nations. You can also, like I said, make contracts and agreements without actually being part of the nation. You can just take one smart contract template with one law and then make like one agreement, that's it. Then you have the proof of collective, which is the reputations that nations earn. So that's something different, and this is something that only pertains to the nation itself. So yeah, every nation themselves, like if they can also create their own token, have their own reputation system if they want, that will be only inside of that. But if you leave the nation, go to another one or use different ones, you have also this overarching proof of agreement, this actually the reputation that is registered and allocated by the AI bot. This is like the universal one on Pangea. But the proof of collective is just for the different nations, and maybe nations themselves establish their own reputation mechanisms that only work inside of them. It's up to themselves. And you also have proof of nomic, which is the reputation that are not earned by, let's say, people or nations, but they are earned by the templates. So you also can choose between the quality of smart contract templates based on the quality of the code and of the quality of the law itself.
Are there templates for like nation structure or are
creators? Yes, that's what we are creating right now. We are creating exactly this, the smart contracts, so that nations can be issued and executed on the Ethereum blockchain.
And you said that one individual can create more and more files than Stoneville and then like trick the others. Because I'm just thinking like this is the exact opposite of the blockchain advantages, that you place, the way I always imagine it, all the important credentials and documents into like sort of one chain. So I would expect this would be the last thing to ever be possible to happen.
To have various
yeah.
profiles or to have various identities.
Because one ID, one real password, you know.
So I think you could have different identities for different services. Like you could use, for example, the like real physical information for the blockchain ID and for a passport and this kind of things. But maybe you would want to use some other services pseudonymously because you would be persecuted by your government. For example, if you're a gay couple in Iran and you want to marry, to have marriage and to protect your assets, which you could not do inside of the Iranian jurisdiction. So you could use pseudonymous accounts to still do the blockchain marriage and to protect your assets, but have also the physical ID or the with your real identity for a travel document.
Mm-hmm. How would you know if I have two phones or several ones or several accounts and I manage to scam contracts in the beneficial of one of my accounts? Let's say I create some contracts in some nation, or even I create some fake nation in some way, but they are all real accounts since they are pseudonymous with some emails or addresses or anything, and since there are no negative reputation, so how would the system recognize this?
That's a really good question. Like, I'm not sure about the technical implementation of this. Maybe we have some cyber security measure to prevent, let's say, like several accounts from the same IP address or something like that, at least to block the very easiest like bot attack. But of course, I know that it's easy to circumvent this. So you would have to think of some other mechanisms, but I'm not sure about the IT aspect of this. Like, I think we will see this when it actually happens, like when we start doing this and then this kind of things happen in the testnet, and then we will like have the trial and error process, you know, like when this kind of things happen, we will see like which measures are the most efficient to block this kind of attempts.
Would be very important, because at the very beginning, if someone realized that, it would be very easy to start growing reputation for some fake contracts from the beginning in some government.
Yeah, it's definitely we should check now with the testnet. Like I said, we have like this one financial incentive, like with the costs, but apart from that, I'm not sure about. Like, because we want to encourage people to have several identities because of this issue with governments, and because we actually don't want to restrict people in the way they use this. But yes, it's like a conflict. It's this conflict between abusing the system but also having new opportunities that we didn't have before.
But it's trade-off about how much information are you able to provide about yourself, you know? Because there could be nation which are quite open and you discover your identity, and it made more trust than some nations which are quite like anonymous.
Yeah, I mean, it really depends on the nations themselves. They also set up the constitution, they set up the requirements for people to join them, and what is required from each citizen. And there could be like completely pseudonymous nations, or like maybe Estonia or these kind of nations that actually want to offer their services. They would probably like require all kinds of verifications. So there would be a whole variety of requirements for people to join nations, and it will be up to the market, let's say, to decide what is best for them.
Do you foresee how this could ever challenge the governance structures in terms of, I don't know, some of the big decisions, like they're going to invade Syria, they're going to cut down the forest here, they're going to expand the mine and force the village people out, or these sort of things?
So like I said before, like with this Aboriginal tribes and people who are left without their voice, they could use virtual nation to reclaim their sovereignty, for example, or to express, let's say, their concerns, or maybe even to allow people to just stop using the existing system, the jurisdiction that makes this kind of decisions, to show their disagreement, basically. So in the end, it's about the money, like about how much they use the services of the government, or if they prefer to choose this kind of services. And if enough people leave the existing system and opt into this, then the existing nation states will be forced to change and to also evolve. That's the whole idea of the competition, because like I said in the beginning, when you have a monopoly, you have no incentive to improve yourself. But as soon as you have a competition like this, also the existing nation states have to change themselves.
So how would
we...
So how would it be possible to participate in the ICO? Do you have already some arrangements with some major exchange houses, or is it all mentioned in the website, or how is it?
So we already did the pre-sale, which was just for bigger investors, so they got a discount. We did this through Bitcoin Suisse, but it was too bureaucratic. Like, they required all the KYC requirements, and we had to give away your pass documents and this kind of like private information. And for the public sale, we're starting probably, like, we don't have a fixed date because we really want to provide the software first. We say like in the end of this month or in the beginning of February. This should be able to access without any like government's ID or anything like that. So, and also the investment amount will be undefined. Like, you can invest as much as you want or as little as you want. And basically, the exchanges, so we are first of all doing the wallet integrations. Right now we have created our own wallet, and we integrate into MyEther wallet and into Ox, I think. And then like to some others, like depending on how they see us. Like, we just start with the ones that's for free, and you can just do it in the open source code. And with the exchanges, I think we would first maybe aim for Changely and for some other, you know, like more open-minded exchanges. But we don't have like specific agreements yet. We first do the token sale, and I think then throughout the token sale we do the agreements with the exchanges, because then we get more bargaining power with them. Because from the start, they wouldn't even talk to you. They want like 30% commission of everything, or it's like.
So the token sale would be like just through the website in some way, like I want to invest like this amount, and you would receive in your account, in your wallet, the coins, and that's that.
I'm not 100% sure what we do now for the public token sale. I think we're doing it with Polychain Capital or something like that. I'm not sure. Like, we will see this like at the end of this month when we actually started. But it's sure that we will definitely not allow something like with Bitcoin Swiss to happen again, where, for example, people who had IDs with non-Latin characters were discriminated, like the software wouldn't treat it. So, all, for example, Russian or Asian investors, they couldn't even access because of the software, or they needed to have like some one translators to access it, and was like very difficult. So of course we want to make it really much more easier onboarding process where everything goes much faster and where you don't have to give away your real identity. So if you have no more questions or doubts, so I think it's enough for today, or do you want to add anything? All right, so thanks for your time. Thanks for coming.
I was curious when I saw this.